repeating. It's a story that ends the same, of a man gone astray, and the price he must pay, he's the only one who's to blame. In the quaint little town of Flemington, on the 2nd of January, Bruno sat in that room, and the state asked his doom, while the world listened to that story. On the jury sat four good women, on the jury sat eight good men, and the judge said proceed, and the state said indeed, while defense said go prove it then. Lindy's wife, the state's first witness, January 3rd was the day, and she held in her hand, as she said on the stand, the suit her dear child wore away. Colonel Lindy was the state's next witness, said he paid though his child was dead. Under oath there he swore that he heard hey doctor, just the same as Hauptmann had said. Was the ninth when they called Doc Condon, and he said with a voice that rang true, that the kidnapper John was Bruno Hauptmann. Bruno turned pale when Jaffsy got through. And they called a handwriting expert, Mr. Osborne was that man's name, and he swore Hauptmann wrote each ransom note. Bruno snarled, for he knew no shame. You're a liar, yelled Bruno Hauptmann to the agent Tom Sisk on the stand. As the jury he told, they found notes of gold that were given the kidnapper's hand. Helen Aiken, Brock Bruno's neighbor, told how Bruno had limped one day, when a voice with a ring hollered, you were lying, Miss Hauptmann was heard to say. Then the state through attorney Willens to the kind-hearted judge Trenchard said, sir, the state rests its case, and he's sold in that place. You, the state, demanded Bruno dead. The defense called their first witness January the 24th day. Bruno then took the stand, on the Bible his hand, and he swore that the truth he would say. On the 28th he admitted that he lied to the New York police. In a voice hoarse and bold, then his story he told the jury he was with his niece. Bruno Hauptmann was cross-examined, and this was what he told. Said it was the wish of Isidore Fish that he kept the shoebox of gold, but he wouldn't explain the address that was found in his small closet wall. First he answered with yes, then he said no, I guess, and the jury listened to it all. When they asked why he hid that money in the wall with the auger holes, well, he mumbled a sigh, trying hard to reply just how to explain his bankroll. He denied that piece of pine wood, he denied about the ladder too, he denied every word the jury had heard, and he said that each word was untrue. On the 13th day of February, the judge charged the jury, and he said, judge him fair when you all get in there and deliberate honestly. On the jury sat four good women, the jury sat eight good men. When the jury came out, not a face had a doubt, they had dealt true justice then. Oh, this story is worth repeating, it's a story that ends the same. When a man goes astray, there's a price he must pay, he's the only one who's to blame. On the last great day in heaven, when the master calls out each name, will you stand with the blessed in each?